Good Easter morn. Welcome to our service, our celebration of the resurrection. Christ is risen. As we end our journey of Holy Week, and now we stand at the empty tomb and we're ready for the next, what happens next. As always, I bring to your attention the various announcements that you will see in your bulletin. I don't think I have anything in particular to add at this point, and so, well, I will, apart from the fact, it's always something kind of I need to remember at the last moment, a reminder that we have our Zoom service tomorrow, our Easter communion. Oh, I think I've just given the game away, folks. I'm supposed to create this sense of timelessness. Just now, for those who are interested, here's a bit of Easter trivia for you. This is Easter Saturday. I may as well go the whole hog. This is Easter Saturday. And in the Christian tradition, they developed the idea that when Jesus was in the tomb, he wasn't just lying around waiting for something to happen. They got into the idea that it's an awesome term. The term is the harrowing of hell. And what that means is that Jesus actually supposedly went into the underworld, went into hell, and started fighting off all the devils and the demons inhabited there until he confronted the big boss demon and free humanity. It makes it sound like some kind of video game. You go through layer after layer after layer after layer until you meet the big boss and win. That's what apparently Jesus did. That's a good example of the Protestant work ethic. You can't just have Jesus just lying around doing nothing in the tomb. He has to go out and do something, which is probably a terrible thing for me to have just said. The United Church lets in all sorts. It really does. So that little distraction, let's get folks back into the Easter time. At 12 o'clock on Easter Sunday morning, afternoon, we will have our celebration of communion, Zoom communion. So as always, I invite you to have your elements ready, whatever elements you will have. I will enjoy some water of life as part of my elements. And afterwards, if you want to have a bit of a conversation, I would suggest maybe bring along a hot cross bun or some baked goods to have a time of conversation afterwards, and a reminder that we are the body of Christ, that we are part of a community that finds sometimes it's challenging to find ways to connect with one another. But, we have a time of fellowship. So that is our Easter, our live Easter service, which I assume you'll watch this, and then you'll get the live updates afterwards. Let us continue our celebration of Easter. From the resurrection of Christ, a new and purifying wind can blow into the present world. If a few human beings would really believe this and would let themselves be touched and moved in their earthly behavior, much would change. To live from resurrection, that is indeed the meaning of Easter. Our opening hymn is Jesus Christ is Risen Today, Voices United 155. That's 155.
Thank you.
join the faithful women as they approach the tomb of your son. Hearts heavy, wondering what happens now. But lo, there is good news. Christ is risen. God be with us as we are invited by this good news to embrace the hope of new life, new beginnings in the midst of difficult days. Amen. Let's join together in a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Grace must find expression in life, otherwise it is not grace. Let us come before God in confession. God be with us. We stand in front of the empty tomb. Christ is risen. Yet we wonder, what happens now? What is hoped from us? Are we ready to share this good news with others? Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The empty tomb is a place of fear and wonder. It is a place for new beginnings. Thanks be to God. Let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We shall now continue with Now the Green Blade Rises, Voices United 186. That's 186.
In the grave they laid him, love by hatred slain. We share in God's word. A reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Salome, and Mary, the mother of James, brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And early on the next day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right hand, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Risen, he is risen, hallelujah, Christ is risen. Let the blessed faith throughout the world and lift this Easter day. Hallelujah, hallelujah, sing a joyful hallelujah. Let us celebrate the wonderful mass. Let the earth that's risen, let the people sing.
earlier on, I alluded to the whole kind of the question of our recording setup and schedule and all that kind of stuff. Last week, I had one of those moments where, as I've mentioned in the before, now and again, I have some of my best ideas for sermons in the shower just before I'm supposed to be coming over to the church. That happened to me last week on Sunday. I had this brilliant idea. I was so kind of caught up the idea. I was actually going to post it on the Facebook page and all that kind of stuff. And I said, you know what? Just let it go. The reason I did that is because I actually had something pop into my head a few minutes before the start of today's service. And this time I feel lucky enough to be able to write it down. One of the things that is very much one of my trademarks is the importance of the original audiences, of the first people who heard the books, the words, the stories of Scripture. What did it mean for them? You know, we have our interpretations, shaped by our experiences, by doctrine, by history, and all those kind of bits and pieces. But what did the original audiences think? And of course, that's a very difficult thing for us to do. We're operating with limited information, and a lot of it is educated guesswork at best, knowing the circumstances that the people found themselves in. But I was particularly thinking about this, and for those who have watched From Jesus to Christ, you probably have, you might be able to slot in some of the pieces yourself. Particularly this with Mark. One of the things that kind of popped into my head just before the start of the service was the fragility of hope. And I think this is very much something I associate with the audience of Mark. Mark writes at a time of a group coping with trauma to varying degrees. The Gospel of Mark was written probably very close to the aftermath of the Jewish revolt of AD, CE 66 to CE 70, Common Era, to a group of people who had been scarred by this experience, who had seen an attempt to restore the hope of Israel not just fail, but fail traumatically with the destruction of Jerusalem itself. That when in the Gospel of Mark and later when Jesus talks about how he proclaims the destruction of the temple, that is written by someone who may well have seen the ruins of the temple. So this is a group of people in shock and a time of what is the term is used, a time of definition. What does it mean to be a follower in Jesus in the time of shock? What can you hope for? What happens now? And I think Mark, in many ways, this common theme I have of being the first, you can be the most honest. You don't know how the audience is going to respond, so you throw the stuff out, see what happens. And with Mark, with that ending that we heard today in the reading, they were amazed and terrified. And that's how the Gospel of Mark ends, with fear, wonder, and terror. They said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now, when that original audience would hear those words, there would be some muttering. How is this good news? They were terrified, but there would be others who would understand that. They understood the fragility of hope. That sometimes, as a victim of trauma, you are not yet ready to fully embrace the hope of possibilities of new life, of promise. That yes, you are frightened and you are terrified. You may be amazed at the idea that someone has reached a hand out to you and given you a second chance, but are you ready to take it? Mark's vision of the resurrection is the first written source we have of the event itself. And I think it's safe to say, you know, I have this vision of Matthew and Luke and John looking at it saying, yeah, that's a great start, but wow, it's not going to play well. We're going to need to punch this up, folks. We're going to need some scenes of crowds, a great commission, Jesus chilling with his pals, you know, give him something else, Mark, not this. They fled in fear and terror, like, wow, are you trying to bury the lead here? Matthew, Luke, and John create accounts of the resurrection that almost are like reassuring. Yeah, it's going to work out great. Chill. You know, yeah, Jesus has moved on, but he's still going to be with us in ways that, get nice and comfortable too. Yeah, he'll share meals with us. We will recognize him in the breaking of bread. But Mark is like, no, yeah, it's complicated. The fragility of hope. Because putting your hope in the resurrection of Christ Jesus for Mark is something that is fragile. It is something that, yeah, should be concerning, should be frightening. What happens next? Jesus is resurrected, the tomb is empty, but he will not remain physically with us. We don't know what Mark thinks, how long Jesus stays with us or whatever. We have the different accounts. But yeah, Jesus will leave. It will only be for a few days. Through his resurrection, we have been touched by the presence of God and invited to be part of the hope of the kingdom of God. Yet as Mark reminds us in his gospel, this is not necessarily the path to happiness as the world understands such things. That to become part of the hope of God is maybe something that should fill us with wonder and terror at the same time, especially when we live in difficult times. Because when you're part of something that will change the world, you will face the reality that there is a great number of people who don't want the world to be changed. That's why Jesus was nailed to a cross. He was a voice of change in a world where those in charge did not want to hear such a message. And Mark wants us to be ready to confront such realities and to be aware that we share in the struggles of other followers of Jesus facing these challenges. With the way of Christ Jesus, people have to face the question, how will we be faithful to the hope of Jesus when he's no longer physically amongst us? That is why we have the church, the body of Christ, a vision of community who will strive to be the living presence of Christ in the world. And yes, in difficult times, that is sometimes more difficult to visualize than others, but we are still part of that body. How do we picture that? Well, we've got the complicated things, the ecclesiology and all this kind of stuff and whatever, but to me it is boiled down to one phrase. Jesus says to us, your life is my life. That as a member of the body of Christ, we're invited to celebrate that we are beloved of God. And that God is convinced that despite what we may believe about ourselves, that we are worthy of that love. And it is through God's ongoing relationship with humanity, God is convinced that we are worthy of this love. As I've mentioned before, and yeah, I'll mention again, God has witnessed that we are capable of so many things, both wondrous, things that fill God with wonder and fear. That we are capable of loving one another in both regular and difficult times, at the same time struggling to love one another. And the events of the Holy Week are such illustrations of that. For example, one of my favorite moments is the incident of the woman who physically manifests the extravagance of grace by anointing Jesus with perfume. So what do the followers of Jesus and all the other hangers around do? When they see this moment of grace, instead they engage in some good old mansplaining. Oh, she got it wrong. She should have sold that perfume and given it to the poor and everyone would live happily after. Yeah, right, as if they already had been thinking along those lines. They got Jesus more than this woman got Jesus, because how could she get Jesus when she wastes his perfume? You can almost see them looking at Jesus like, yeah, we got it right, didn't we? And Jesus like, no, you didn't. Another Jesus facepalm moment. They didn't get the difference between serving those in need, which you should do with a joyous, wondrous heart, and serving those in need because you've been told to get your brownie points. And they didn't understand the need of the wondrous gesture of grace, of extravagance from a woman who saw that things were happening and decided to act, to anoint Jesus, to be ready. From that moment, what do you think Jesus remembers? An act of extravagant love that mirrors the love of God for us? Or the posturing of those who are convinced that they will impress Jesus with their glib mansplaining? What memory do we hope is the one that inspires Jesus? And then the more unfortunate question, what memory of Jesus do we see enacted in the witness of the church? Unfortunately, I think too often we are the church of mansplaining, not the church of extravagant grace. Thankfully, for Jesus, it is the memory of an act of extravagant love that will inspire Jesus to share with us the invitation to live out this his hope, that our lives will be his life, lives of sharing in extravagant love with others. And it fills us with fear and terror. And it is fragile because we do not have that faith in ourselves. We are fearful that, yes, if we give in to this, and it's almost that language you use, if we give in to the hope that we're going to get hurt, that people will let us down. They will. Let's not kid ourselves. That is the human condition. The fragility of hope is that people will let you down, that you will try your best and it may not work and you will let someone down and all this kind of, yeah, it happens. But grace is always there. God's love is always there. We may not change the lives of others for our hope, yet God gives thanks for our efforts. God gives thanks for our willingness to have faith that something will happen. That our love will shatter the expectations of how this world should be. And it invites us to be part of the hope of God. It fills us with terror and amazement because we confront the wonder of being so loved by God that God, through Jesus Christ, takes this path to always be with us. Mark spoke to a people struggling with the fragility of hope and said, Jesus is with us. His life is now our life. It is a path of new beginnings, a new way of life. We are being invited to be free of the ways of this world that are all too often the death to the hope of God, and fulfill the hope of Jesus that our lives will be his life in this world. So once more, the question is, what happens now? Jesus is waiting. At this time, we come before God and give thanks in our offerings to the ongoing life of this congregation, that we strive to be the life of Jesus in this world in these difficult days. And we give thanks to all the members of this congregation and who share their gifts of time, talent, and treasure in so many wonderful, diverse ways. We give thanks for their faith in resurrection. And as we continue to hope for better days, for resurrection, for the church and for the world, we give thanks that hope is still with us. Amen. We come before God in prayer. God, we gather before you. In this season of resurrection, we confess to our weariness, our struggles, our yearning for the comfort of familiarity. Yet, in resurrection, you invite us to be part of something new. Even in difficult times, there is hope for what is to come as we continue to find ways to connect with one another in the present. So God, we pray that you'll open our hearts to your vision of resurrection, the promise of new life in difficult times, as we struggle with the fragility of hope. We remember that it is connected with the humanity of Jesus, that in Jesus himself endured such fragility, to invite us to be part of his vision of the kingdom of God. So God, we give you thanks, and we bring to you in prayer those who have been the signs of your hope in these difficult days. We give thanks for all who serve, for those who ensure that our world continues as it can, ensure that we are fed, that we have food, water, heat, and the tools to connect with one another. May we never forget what they endured on our behalf. We give thanks for all in the field of healthcare, especially in these days of vaccinations, when we see the light at the end of the tunnel. We pray for patience, hope, and a continuing willingness to serve one another in these difficult days, to be present to one another. So in silence, we bring to you the signs of resurrection that we have seen in the people and around us, O God. God, we pray for our world, struggling to have hope, struggling to have faith in better days. The ongoing presence and legacy of COVID-19, the conflicts between nations, the conflicts between ideologies, our unfortunate desire to oppress one another, those who claim to be persecuted when in reality all they are doing is being challenged for their desire to persecute others. We pray for all who struggle, all who suffer, those who yearn for hope. We pray for the leaders of nations that they will realize that we're all in this together, until they, that they will learn from the example of those who serve. We pray for our province in the midst of turmoil, economic, political, and social. We pray for wisdom in our leaders and a willingness to do what must be done to protect the people of this province. And God, we come to you with the prayers of our hearts for those who we know who struggle with illness of mind, body, and spirit, for those who are alone, for those who yearn for connection. In silence, we bring these names to you. Amen. Our closing hymn is "We Shall Go Out with Hope of Resurrection," and I hope I'd do a better job of this than I did in our St. Patrick's Day service when I made a complete and utter hash of it, or should I say Irish stew of it. So "We Shall Go Out with Hope of Resurrection," Voices United 586. It starts at the empty tomb. Women inspired by the love of God hope to serve God one more time. Instead, they are invited to share the promise of the new life in the midst of the darkness of our world. A promise we are invited to share with others. A promise revealed for our acts of care and compassion in serving one another. And in doing so, celebrate. The kingdom of God awaits us and is among us. Amen.